Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Revelation Through Old Testament Eyes by Tremper Longman III, narrated by Timothy Andrés Pabon. Publisher's note, in this audio edition you will hear references to tables and visual materials present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Series Preface. The New Testament writers were Old Testament people. Their minds were populated with Old Testament stories and concepts. Their imaginative world was furnished with Old Testament images, motifs, metaphors, symbols, and literary patterns. When Jesus came and turned much of their conventional wisdom on its head, they largely had Old Testament tools to understand what was going on in order to explain Jesus to others and to themselves. So that's what they used. For many Christians, the Old Testament has unfortunately become a closed book. It seems long, mysterious, and boring, with a confusing history full of many strange, unpronounceable names. And then there are those sometimes bizarre prophecies populated with strange creatures. Yet my consistent experience in teaching the New Testament is that when I turn the attention of students to relevant Old Testament passages, the proverbial light bulbs go on. The room is filled with ahas. Formerly obscure New Testament passages suddenly make new sense in light of the old. Indeed, the whole of each book of the New Testament takes on fuller, richer dimensions not seen before. The purpose of the Through Old Testament Eyes commentaries is to give preachers, teachers, and other readers this same experience. This series opens the New Testament in greater depth to anyone who wants to see fresh ways that Scripture interconnects with Scripture. Scholars have long known that the Old Testament influenced the New Testament, an idea known as intertextuality. In fact, more than a millennia and a half ago, Augustine famously proposed that we understand the relationship of the two testaments in this way. The new is in the old concealed. The old is in the new revealed. Yet no commentary series is as devoted as this one is to seeing the richness of Old Testament allusions, references, echoes, and background to illuminate both puzzling passages and explain others in fresh ways. Practices like baptism, meals, fishing, and fasting, concepts like rescue, faith, sin, and glory, and terms like wilderness, Sabbath, and Lord are just a few of the dozens of words in each New Testament book and letter with deep Old Testament resonances. Sometimes a narrative arc or an argument is also shaped by the Old Testament. An appreciation of this background enriches our understanding and helps us appropriately apply each passage. In these commentaries, you will find four repeating features which will enrich your encounter with the Scripture. Running commentary. Verse by verse or paragraph by paragraph commentary will include Old Testament background as well as other key information to give readers an understanding of the text as a whole and to answer questions as they naturally arise. Through Old Testament Eyes. Periodic summaries offer overviews of chapters or sections. These occasional pauses give the opportunity to step back from the detail to see the bigger picture of how Old Testament themes and motifs are being used by the New Testament authors. What the structure means. New Testament authors often get their points across through the way they structure their material. The very organization of their writing conveys significant meaning in and of itself. How the events and teachings are linked makes a difference that, while not explicit, is an important part of the message. Again, it is important to not take verses out of context as if they were timeless truths standing apart from their original settings, which affect how we understand them. The authors of the New Testament also deliberately use, for example, repetition, contrast, hyperbole, metaphor, story, and other techniques, so they can have the maximum impact on their readers. What the structure means will highlight these every so often and help us keep track of the overall flow of each book and letter so that the Old Testament background can be seen in its proper context. Going deeper. New Testament writers did not want merely to convey information. They wrote with the needs of the early church in mind. what should their attitude be toward family members who weren't Christians? How should they respond to challenges from Jewish or Roman authorities? What about internal disputes within the church? These and many other issues were on their minds, and the New Testament addresses them and many more. Through Old Testament eyes, commentaries will not only leave readers with an enriched understanding of the text, but with enriched lives. In going deeper, the authors will unpack the practical implications of each book and letter for Christians and churches, especially drawing from the Old Testament dimensions uncovered in the text. As much of this series champions the importance of understanding the New Testament's use of the Old, two key points need to be mentioned. First, the Old Testament is not merely a tool for understanding the New. The Old Testament is important and valuable in its own right. It was the Bible of Jesus and the first Christians. They guided their lives by it. The Old Testament needs to be and deserves to be understood on its own terms, apart from the lens it provides for seeing the New Testament clearly. All the commentary authors in this series begin just here as they approach the text. In fact, our hope is that these commentaries will be a window into the Old Testament that will motivate many listeners to look more deeply into what some have called the First Testament. Second, the Old Testament is not the only interpretive lens we need to understand the New. Roman and Greek culture and history, for example, had a very significant influence on the New Testament era. So did the Second Temple period, from the start of rebuilding the temple about 537 BC to the destruction of the temple by Rome in AD 70. Where essential, these commentaries will reference such background material, but the emphasis will be on providing in-depth Old Testament background that readers too often overlook. While these commentaries are grounded in solid scholarship, they are not intended primarily for an academic audience. For this reason, many topics, approaches, and debates found in technical commentaries are absent. This series is for those who want to teach or preach, as well as any serious reader committed to understand Scripture. The past is always present. The question is, are we aware of how it affects us or not? The Old Testament was present with the New Testament writers. They knew that and treasured it. We can too. Andrew T. LePeau, Series Editor. Introduction and Main Theme of the Book of Revelation. Ask many people who read the Bible, casually or seriously, and a large percentage will say that the Book of Revelation is hard to understand. Not only that, but they find it strange, even bizarre. In one sense, I can't blame them. The first three chapters are relatively tame, but even in the introduction and the letters to the seven churches, we read about one coming with the clouds, chapter 1, verse 7, the mystery of seven stars and seven golden lampstands, chapter 1, verse 20. The glorified Christ rebukes a group called the Nicolaitans, chapter 2, verses 6 and 15, a synagogue of Satan, chapter 2, verse 9, those who hold to the teachings of Balaam, chapter 2, verse 14, and that woman Jezebel, chapter 2, verse 20. Churches that resist the temptation to compromise are promised hidden manna as well as a white stone with a new name written on it, chapter 2, verse 17. When readers reach the visions that start in Revelation chapter 4 and extend to the end, the imagery seems overwhelming. A short list includes a seven-sealed scroll, four horsemen bringing destruction and death, 144,000 people with a seal on their foreheads, horse-like locusts from the abyss with scorpion tails and faces like humans, a woman battling a dragon, a beast from the sea and a beast from the earth, and a great prostitute called Babylon the Great. This constitutes just a few of the things that confound most modern readers of the book. The difficulty, though, is not because of the complexity of the Book of Revelation, but rather because we modern readers are unfamiliar with imagery that would have been known to its first readers. These images, for the most part, were not created out of thin air, but have a background not only in 1st century AD Greco-Roman culture, but also in the Old Testament, which itself has its background in ancient Near Eastern literature. Thus, it is important to familiarize ourselves with that background. This commentary has as its focus Revelation's Old Testament background. It's important to recognize that Revelation is not as esoteric as many assume, because some writers take advantage of a modern reader's, and often their own, lack of knowledge of the background to make all kinds of outlandish claims about the message of the book of Revelation. This includes those who might use the book as a source to predict the timing and nature of Christ's return. Recent, well-known, popular treatments would include those by Hal Lindsey, Harold Camping, Tim LaHaye, and many Sunday morning TV preachers. Truth be told, Revelation's main theme is as clear as day. Despite present trouble, God is in control and He will have the final victory. God wins in the end, even though His people at the present live in a toxic culture and are marginalized and even persecuted. This leads to a secondary theme, hope that leads to perseverance. Starting in the letters to the seven churches, but continuing through the visions, the author's purpose is to engender hope in the hearts of his Christian readers so that they will have the resolve to withstand the turbulent present. Of course, these messages are for those who respond to John's admonition to hear the book and take to heart what is written in it, chapter 1, verse 3. Those who don't will find judgment, or, as the glorified Christ warned the church of Ephesus, have their lampstand taken away. Chapter 2, verse 5. Author and date. The very first chapter of Revelation makes it clear that the book was written by John. He was the one who received the revelation that constitutes the contents of the book. God revealed the visions of the book by sending His angel to His servant John, who testifies to everything he saw. Revelation chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. John then writes a letter to the seven churches in the province of Asia, Revelation chapter 1, verse 4. The letters themselves in Revelation chapters 2 and 3 come from the glorified Christ. He further discloses that at the time he received the revelation from God and wrote the letter, he was on the island of Patmos, Revelation chapter 1, verse 9, presumably in exile because of his faith. In this verse, he identifies himself with the recipients of his letter as their brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus. At the end of the book, he summarily states, "I, John, am the one who heard and saw these things, and when I had heard and seen them, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who had been showing them to me." Chapter 22, verse 8. Though John only appears by name in these four mentioned verses, he makes his presence known through many first-person references. Thus, the book clearly claims to have John as its originator and author. But who is John? Or another way to ask this question is, which John? After all, John was a popular name during the first century after Christ. Besides some minor characters, there are at least two, and more likely three, Johns who play a significant role in the New Testament, though only two are likely candidates. The first John mentioned in the Gospels is John the Baptist, but he is certainly not the author of the book of Revelation. He was the herald who announced the coming of the Messiah at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, Matthew chapter 3. But John was executed by Herod before the crucifixion of Christ, Matthew chapter 14, verses 1 through 12, so he was not alive at the time the book was written. Perhaps the most likely candidate for the authorship of Revelation is John the Apostle, who is also credited with writing the Gospel of John, though he is not so named in the Gospel. John was part of the inner circle of disciples, Luke chapter 8, verse 51, and was a witness along with Peter of the transfiguration of Christ, Matthew chapter 17, verses 1 through 13. He also played a leading role in the development of the church after the resurrection of Christ, even being arrested along with Peter for his public witness to Jesus, Acts chapter 4, verses 1 through 22. But in the modern era, the idea that John the Apostle wrote Revelation has been challenged, mainly on the grounds that the language of the Gospel of John and Revelation could not come from the same person. Among those who reject the authorship of John the Apostle, many say that the book of Revelation was written by the author of the three letters of John, who was actually not named in these three letters beyond being called the Elder. 2 John chapter 1 verse 1, 3 John chapter 1 verse 1. Tradition, though, names the elder John, some thinking that John the Elder is the same as John the Apostle, and others who think they are two different people. So who is the John who wrote Revelation? John the Apostle? John the Elder? A third man named John? No one knows for sure. Fortunately, the exact identity of John, the author of Revelation, is unimportant for the meaning of the book. We will simply refer to the author as John. But when did John write Revelation? The answer to this question, too, is uncertain, since no date is explicitly provided. Of course, since the church seems well established in Western Asia Minor, as the reference to the churches in the seven letters in Revelation chapters 2 through 3 make clear, we are talking some decades after the death of Christ. The book also indicates conflict between the church and Rome, so that one of the main purposes of the book is to encourage its readers to persevere in the face of opposition and even persecution. Still, there is no explicit mention of specific Roman emperors or specific historical events. On the other hand, Revelation chapter 13, verse 18, see commentary, informs the reader that the number of the beast is 666, which, besides being a number of imperfection, is suggestive of the name of Nero, who ruled the Roman Empire from AD 54 to 68. In AD 64, a great fire broke out in Rome that Nero blamed on Christians, who were then persecuted. The Roman historian Tacitus wrote that Nero himself set the fire and used Christians as a scapegoat. Nero died at the young age of 31, likely having taken his own life. There then arose, particularly in the eastern part of the empire, a myth that he would come back from the dead. Some scholars connect this Nero Revivus myth to the statement that the beast seemed to have had a fatal wound, but the fatal wound had been healed, Revelation chapter 13, verse 3. Thus, some scholars believe that Revelation was written soon after the time of Nero, perhaps in the late 60s. But even if, as seems likely, these references in Revelation do allude to Nero, that does not require that the book be written that early. An argument is also to be made that the book was written in the 90s during the reign of another persecutor of Christians, namely Domitian, who ruled the Roman Empire from AD 81 through 96. The arguments in favor of this later date include the fact that emperor worship, about which John warns in Revelation, was more developed by this time. Also, as Metzger and Da Silva point out, the church at Smyrna, according to the testimony of Polycarp, who served as bishop in that city in the early 2nd century, did not form until after Paul, making a date in the 60s unlikely. Also, they point out that Laodicea, described as wealthy in chapter 3, verse 17, suffered an earthquake in AD 61, and so it is unlikely that they regained their status as early as the end of that decade. This view is the majority view, not only today, but among the leaders of the early church. For example, Irenaeus writing around AD 180. The weight of the evidence tilts toward a later date in the 1st century AD for the composition of the book of Revelation, though we cannot be dogmatic. Fortunately, as with the exact identification of the author, the specific date of composition also does not bear on the meaning of the book. Genre triggers reading strategy. Authors send signals to readers as to how to take their words. A commonly cited and obvious example of such a signal is a story that begins once upon a time. Unless an author is trying to be mischievous, readers know that what follows is a fairy tale. This is not the place to develop a nuanced genre theory that would take account of fuzzy boundaries between genres, the acknowledgement that literary texts actually participate in multiple genres, though some are more influential on our reading than others, the pros and cons of using modern literary categories to describe ancient genres, and so forth. For our present purpose, it will suffice to focus briefly on the main genres of the book with a focus on how it affects our reading strategy. Interestingly, the book rather obviously communicates its genres through its form and through self-identification. The form of the book is a letter. There are seven individual letters in which the glorified Christ writes to different churches in Asia Minor, Revelation chapter 2 and 3. But we should not miss the signal that the entirety of the book, the seven letters and the visions, is a letter written by John to the seven churches in the province of Asia, Revelation chapter 1, verse 4, which has a benediction upon the recipients of the letter typical to letters of the time period. That the whole book is a letter is confirmed by the ending benediction on the reader, again typical of letters of the time. That the book of Revelation is in the form of a letter is a reminder that the contents of the book address the existential issues of the church at the time of its writing. We can see also from the contents of the seven letters that the churches were marginalized and threatened by the wider culture. We also learn that some of the churches and individual Christians were tempted to give in to the pressure and compromise their faith. They needed to hear a message of hope and receive encouragement to persevere. And that is where the second genre comes in. The very first verse of the book identifies it as a revelation from Jesus Christ, Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. The word revelation translates the Greek word apokalypsis and gives us our English word apocalypse. Revelation is an apocalypse. True, the book identifies itself as a prophecy, chapter 1, verse 3, and chapter 22, verses 7, 10, 18, and 19, but an apocalypse is a prophecy of a distinct type. Revelation is such an apocalypse bearing formal and content similarities with Daniel and other Jewish and Christian apocalypses of antiquity. Again, this is not the place to give a lengthy definition of the apocalyptic genre. Here I will just list the leading features of an apocalypse which we see manifest in the book of Revelation, followed by a brief statement of how that should guide our readerly expectations. We begin with the statement that an apocalypse like Revelation shares with other prophecy, like, say, Jeremiah, an interest in the future. They also both are interested in the future not for its own sake, but to generate a response from their contemporary readers. However, the reason for this future orientation differs between them. Jeremiah presents a picture of the future which is largely conditional, with the hope that his hearers or readers will repent. John in Revelation presents the future, indeed including a much more distant future, to evoke hope in his readers who are in sore need of it. Another feature of apocalyptic literature is how the future is portrayed, and this may be the most important matter for modern readers to keep in mind. As Revelation looks to the future, it pictures that future using highly figurative language, indeed much of it derived from the Old Testament and ancient Near Eastern mythic language. Beasts from the sea and a divine figure riding a cloud are two obvious examples. Thus, it becomes important for readers to realize the figurative nature of the language to understand the message of the author. We do not need to dwell on this feature, since that is the heart of this commentary, to recognize and explain how Revelation uses the Old Testament to communicate its important message. Even though this discussion will be carried on in the commentary itself, it is important to provide a few general observations to prepare us for what follows. How are we to take the figurative language of the book of Revelation? There are three main options: literally as symbols pointing to a concrete literal reality, or as pointing to a more general literal reality. To illustrate, I will refer to the description found in Revelation chapter 9, verses 3 through 11 of locusts that emerge from the abyss when the fifth angel sounded his trumpet. These locusts are described as having the tails and power of scorpions. They wear crowns and have human-like faces with hair like women and teeth like lions. They have breastplates like iron and wings. It stretches the imagination that this describes a literal locust plague, considering the hybrid nature of these locusts, and, as we will observe in the commentary proper, the figurative use of even ordinary locusts in the Old Testament. Some, though, believe that the metaphors of Revelation, including this one, point to a specific reference that bears what they consider to be similarities to these locusts. That these locusts fly, have hardened shells, and are here described as having stingers, led Hal Lindsey to say that they predicted a future helicopter attack. This type of reading results from a faulty belief that the referent can be found at the time of the interpreter, in this case, Hal Lindsey. It is much more reasonable to understand the analogy in more general terms. These fearful, Hybrid locusts stand for horrific devastation that could take many different forms. They could point to war or to environmental devastation or any number of things. The main teaching is that God will bring judgment on sinful humanity. But is the book of Revelation talking about the past, the present, or the future? The short answer is yes, all of the above. While some people think that Revelation is all about the future, and indeed all about the end times, the book speaks to its contemporary audience by describing what they are presently experiencing, namely marginalization and even persecution, and encouraging them to remain faithful and obedient in the present. While the letters clearly address the issues confronting John's contemporary church, the visions do as well. That said, Revelation is not all about the present and the past. The book does look to the future, and indeed to God's final intervention in history to defeat evil and bring his church to himself. Thus, the original readers would have recognized the relevance of the letters and the visions to their present situation, even as John speaks about the future. But what about us? In particular, what about the church in the 21st century? One of the reasons why the church recognized Revelation as canonical and thus part of our standard of faith and practice is that the church knew that the book of Revelation would remain relevant throughout the ages. Why? Because the church will always, to the end of the history, be under threat of marginalization and persecution. Christians have always and will always live in a culture that is toxic to their faith. Western, and particularly American, Christians sometimes lose sight of this because they live with the fiction that our culture or our nation or our government is or should be Christian. First, this belief is false, as is becoming increasingly clear. And second, this belief is dangerous, as the wedding of political power and Christian faith has time and time again led not to the strengthening of the church, but to its weakening. Indeed, the message of Revelation is to not give up on the faith by falling in lockstep with the culture. This message, by the way, is not a call to culture war, but rather to faithful living in the midst of the culture. But of course, the church is global, not Western. I start with the American church because that is my social location and will almost certainly be the location of most of my listeners. I will simply say, though, that as Americans, we should never lose sight of the fact that many of our brothers and sisters in other parts of the world live in a context that is more like that in which John lived. They live in nations where they are the minority and/or marginalized, and perhaps even persecuted. They will not share the myth that they live in a Christian context. They know their culture is toxic and even dangerous to the faith. Revelation's message of present perseverance and future hope will be readily and encouragingly received. Outline of Revelation. Introduction to the book and the seven letters, 1 through 3. Superscription and blessing. Chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Greetings and doxology. Chapter 1, verses 4 through 8. The glorified Christ commissions, John, chapter 1, verses 9 through 20. The letter to the church in Ephesus, chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. The letter to the church in Smyrna, chapter 2, verses 8 through 11. The letter to the church in Pergamum, chapter 2, verses 12 through 17. The letter to the church in Thyatira, chapter 2, verses 18 through 29. The letter to the church in Sardis, chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. The letter to the church in Philadelphia, chapter 3, verses 7 through 13. The letter to the church in Laodicea, chapter 3, verses 14 through 22. Christ opens the seven seals of the scroll. Chapter 4, verse 1 through chapter 8, verse 5. The Lamb worthy to open the scroll. Chapters 4 and 5. The heavenly throne. Chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. Who is worthy? The Lion of Judah, the Root of David. Chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. The Lamb of God takes the scroll. Chapter 5, verses 6 and 7. The four living creatures and the 24 elders sing a new song. Chapter 5, verses 8 through 10. thousands of angels and every creature join in the worship. Chapter 5, verses 11 through 13. Four living creatures and the elders say Amen. Chapter 5, verse 14. The seven seals. Chapter 6, verse 1 through chapter 8, verse 5. The first seal. Chapter 6, verses 1 and 2. The second seal. Chapter 6, verses 3 and 4. The third seal, chapter 6, verses 5 and 6. The fourth seal, chapter 6, verses 7 and 8. The fifth seal, chapter 6, verses 9 through 11. The sixth seal, chapter 6, verses 12 through 17. Interlude, the 144,000 and the great multitude. Chapter 7, verses 1 through 17. The seventh seal. Chapter 8, verses 1 through 5. The Seven Trumpets. Chapter 8, verse 6 through chapter 11, verse 19. The First Trumpet. Chapter 8, verses 6 through 7. The Second Trumpet. Chapter 8, verses 8 and 9. The Third Trumpet. Chapter 8, verses 10 and 11. The Fourth Angel. Chapter 8, verse 12. Interlude. An Eagle's Funeral Lament. Chapter 8, verse 13. The Fifth Trumpet. Chapter 9, verses 1 through 11. Interlude. One woe done, two to go. Chapter 9, verse 12. The Sixth Trumpet. Chapter 9, verses 13 through 21. Interlude. The Little Scroll. Chapter 10, verses 1 through 11. Interlude. The Two Witnesses. Chapter 11, verses 1 through 13. Interlude. Two woes done, one to go. Chapter 11, verse 14. The Seventh Trumpet. Chapter 11, verses 15 through 19. The Woman versus the Dragon, the Land Beast, and the Sea Beast. Chapters 12 through 13. The Dragon Pursues the Woman. Chapter 12, verses 1 through 17. The Sea Beast. Chapter 13, verses 1 through 10. The Second Beast from the Earth. Chapter 13, verses 11 through 18. The 144,000 again, three angels, harvesting and trampling, chapter 14. The 144,000 sing a new song, chapter 14, verses 1 through 5. Warnings from three angels, chapter 14, verses 6 through 13. Reaping the harvest, salvation, and trampling the grapes, judgment. Chapter 14, verses 14 through 20. The Seven Bowls of God's Wrath. Chapters 15 through 16. Presentation of the Bowls and Angelic Commission. Chapter 15, verse 1 through chapter 16, verse 1. The First Bowl. Chapter 16, verse 2. The Second Bowl. Chapter 16, verse 3. The Third Bowl, chapter 16, verses 4 through 7. The Fourth Bowl, chapter 16, verses 8 and 9. The Fifth Bowl, chapter 16, verses 10 and 11. The Sixth Bowl, chapter 16, verses 12 through 16. The Seventh Bowl, chapter 16, verses 17 through 21. The Demise of the Great Prostitute, chapter 17, verse 1, through chapter 19, verse 10. The Great Prostitute Riding the Beast, chapter 17, verses 1 through 6. The Mystery Explained, chapter 17, verses 7 through 18. Lament over the Destruction of Babylon, chapter 18, verses 1 through 3. God's People Warned to Leave, chapter 18, verses 4 through 8. Three Woes Over Destroyed Babylon, chapter 18, verses 9 through 19. The Kings of the Earth, chapter 18, verses 9 and 10. The Merchants, chapter 18, verses 11 through 17a. Sea Captains and Sailors, chapter 18, verse 17b through chapter 19. Rejoice, chapter 18, verse 20. The End of Babylon the Great, Chapter 18, Verses 21 through 24. Hallelujahs over the destruction of Babylon, Chapter 19, Verses 1 through 10. The final telling of God's ultimate victory, Chapter 19, Verse 11 through Chapter 20, Verse 15. Jesus the warrior wins the final battle, Chapter 19, Verses 11 through 21. The dragon bound 1,000 years, Chapter 20, Verses 1 through 6. The end of the devil, Chapter 20, Verses 7 through 10. The final judgment, Chapter 20, Verses 11 through 15. The future world, Chapter 21, Verse 1 through Chapter 22, Verse 5. A new heaven and a new earth, Chapter 21, Verses 1 through 8. The New Jerusalem, Chapter 21, Verses 9 through 27. A return to Eden, only better, Chapter 22, Verses 1 through 5. Conclusion, Chapter 22, Verses 6 through 21. Final Angelic Instructions, Chapter 22, Verses 6 through 11. Jesus' Final Announcements and Warnings, Chapter 22, Verses 12 through 21. Structure. The outline makes clear the general contour and major sections of the Book of Revelation. I have included the elements of this outline throughout this commentary to indicate key sections, but a few comments are in order as to how the various major parts relate to one another. The book has a clear beginning, opening with a superscription, Chapter 1, Verses 1 through 3, that names its genre or contents a revelation or apocalypse from Jesus Christ. The superscription also names the human intermediary of this revelation, since John received it from an angel. The opening concludes with a blessing pronounced on the one who reads the prophecy aloud and those who hear it and take it seriously. David da Silva highlights the fact that this book was supposed to be read out loud and heard rather than read. The opening then moves to a greeting by John to the addressees of the book, namely the seven churches in the province of Asia on which he pronounces a doxology. This introductory section ends with an exclamation that Jesus is coming on the clouds and a solemn first statement from the glorified Christ himself that he is the Alpha and Omega, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Chapter 1, Verse 8. John, as many prophets in the Old Testament do, also tells the reader the story of his divine commissioning, which intends to bolster his claim to authority, Chapter 1, Verses 9 through 20. Like Moses at the burning bush, Exodus chapter 3, Isaiah in the temple, Isaiah chapter 6, or Ezekiel by the Kebar River, Ezekiel chapters 1 through 3, John gives a vivid picture of his encounter with the glorified Christ on the island of Patmos, where he is living, presumably in exile. Christ commissions him to write what he sees and send it to seven churches in Asia Minor. Not surprisingly, then, in the next two chapters, Revelation chapters 2 and 3, we read seven letters to churches in cities, which, when plotted on a map, suggest the route a messenger would take to visit those seven cities. For details, see what the structure means. The letters to the seven churches, Revelation chapters 2 and 3. Since the seven churches were different in their responses to the faith challenges that they faced, the letters are quite different from each other in content, but all seven share a common purpose and a common structure. See what the structure means, the outline of the seven letters, Revelation chapters 2 and 3. The purpose was to encourage the Christians in these churches with hope, while also exhorting them to remain faithful or in some cases to repent. A significant transition occurs between Revelation chapters 3 and 4. The seventh and final letter is read to the church in Laodicea, and the remainder of the book contains visions that John has experienced. As we will remark again when we consider the closing of the book, it is clear, though, that these visions were also addressed to the seven churches. It is equally clear, thanks to the symbolic nature of the number seven, which implies completeness or totality, that these seven churches represent the church universal of the time. These visions that show God's ultimate victory over evil serve to encourage the churches to remain faithful. In terms of contents, the transition from letters to reports of visions is abrupt and marked by a simple connective, "after this," chapter 4, verse 1. Still, the visions themselves support the main message that runs throughout the book, which is that despite present troubles, God is in control, and He will have the final victory. Therefore, persist in your faith and remain obedient to God. Don't succumb to the evil forces in the world. Right away, John is caught up into the heavenly throne room, which he describes in its magnificence. God's throne is in the center of the picture, surrounded by four living creatures and 24 elders, representing the Old Testament and New Testament people of God. They give God honor and full-throated worship, Revelation chapter 4. The throne is the control center for all the activity that the visions describe. After taking all this in, John's attention is drawn to the right hand of God, which holds a scroll. A mighty angel asks whether there is one who is worthy to open the scroll that has seven seals. While at first John believes that no one will be found, one of the elders tells him to look at the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, chapter 5, verse 5. His worthiness is rooted in his triumph, which points to his death and resurrection. When John sees him, he calls him not the Lion of Judah, but the Lamb looking as if it had been slain, and standing at the center of the throne, thus closely identified with God who is sitting on the throne and receiving worship. Chapter 5, verses 6 through 14. At that point, the Lamb opens the seven seals one by one. With the first four seals, judgment comes on the earth via the famous four horsemen with increasing intensity. The opening of the fifth seal does not bring judgment, but a description of the martyrs who cry out for justice, chapter 6, verses 9 through 11, followed by the sixth seal, chapter 6, verses 12 through 14, the opening of which results in territorial and cosmic convulsions leading to fear on the part of the wicked. Surprisingly, an interlude occurs between the sixth and seventh seal. Revelation chapter 7 speaks of the 144,000 from all the tribes of Israel who receive a seal on their forehead to preserve them from the judgment. After this, John looks and he sees a great diverse multitude before the throne and the Lamb worshiping God. These were those who persisted in the great tribulation, chapter 7, verse 14, and now are with God and the Lamb. In the commentary, we will present arguments that suggest that the 144,000 and the great multitude are the same group of people, God's faithful followers. After this interlude, the Lamb opens the seventh climactic seal, chapter 8, verses 1 through 5. But notice that before the seventh seal is opened, John saw seven angels who stand before God, and seven trumpets were given to them, chapter 8, verse 2. In this way, John presages the next major section, raising the question of how the trumpets relate to the seals. Once the glorified Christ opens the seventh seal, there is momentary silence before an angel throws a censer to the earth, which produces peals of thunder, rumblings, flashes of lightning, and an earthquake. Chapter 8, verse 5. By narrating the emergence of the seven trumpet-bearing angels before the seventh scroll, we see that there is overlap between the picture of judgment, as the unsealing of seven scrolls, and as the blowing of seven trumpets. Indeed, it is best to understand the trumpet judgments not as seven additional and subsequent judgments, but as a recapitulation of the same judgments, not new ones, but perhaps moving closer to a crescendo. This understanding is furthered by some parallels found between the seal and the trumpet judgments, including the first four trumpets forming a unit, the presence of interludes, as well as similarity in the seventh judgment. Like the first four seals picturing the emergence of the four horsemen, the judgments following the blowing of the first four trumpets are briefly told and form a unit, chapter 8, verses 1 through 12. This section is also separated from what follows by an interlude of an eagle announcing the woes of the following three trumpet blasts, chapter 8, verse 13. The fifth trumpet announces a star that represents an angel that falls into the sea, who opens the abyss, loosing fearful hybrid locusts that torture those they sting with their scorpion-like tails. Chapter 9, verses 1 through 11. John announces that this is the first of the threefold woes announced by the angel, with two more to come. Chapter 9, verse 12. The sixth trumpet blast announces the release of four angels who kill a third of mankind. They bring three plagues on humankind, chapter 9, verses 13 through 19. Even so, the survivors chose not to repent, chapter 9, verses 20 and 21. As we heard with the seals, interludes delay the reporting of the seventh trumpet blast. In the first interlude, John sees an angel come down from heaven with a little scroll in his hand. After declaring that there will be no more delay, the angel gives John the scroll and obeys the angel's instructions to eat it, thus signifying that John will prophesy to the diverse peoples of the earth. Chapter 10, verse 11. Next comes a second interlude concerning two witnesses who represent the church as it testifies to the world. Chapter 11, verses 1 through 13. They have great power, but still a beast that comes up from the abyss is able to kill them. However, though their bodies are put on display to the joy of those against whom they spoke, they were soon raised from the dead like their Lord and taken up into heaven. After this vignette, we hear that the second woe, referring back to the sixth trumpet, has passed, and the third woe comes soon, chapter 11, verse 14. The seventh angel then blew his horn, followed by worship, rather than the silence of the seventh seal. But like the seventh seal, the seventh trumpet produces flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder and earthquake, and a severe hailstorm, chapter 11, verse 19. The similarity supports the idea that the relationship between the seals and the trumpets is that the judgments are being recapitulated. Revelation chapters 12 and 13 presents what appears to be a separate and discrete vision that connects to the previous section with a simple and, Chi, chapter 12, verse 1. But it bears similarities to the vision of the two witnesses that served as an interlude between the sixth and seventh trumpet blasts, Revelation chapter 11, verses 1 through 13. The two witnesses represent the church, who come under attack from the beast that comes up from the abyss. While not escaping suffering or even death, the two witnesses are ultimately protected by and cared for by God, and those who celebrate their demise were punished. In the vision found in Revelation chapters 12 and 13, a pregnant woman described in cosmic terms now represents the church. Her evil adversary is a seven-headed red dragon with 10 horns and 7 crowns who represent Satan, chapter 12, verse 9. As the woman, who may also stand for Mary, gives birth to a male child representing Jesus, the dragon tries to devour the child. God takes the child into heaven and sends the woman to a safe place he prepared for her in the wilderness. Revelation chapter 13 turns attention to the emergence of beasts that are allies with the dragon in its war against God's people. The first is a beast from the sea, also with multiple heads, horns, and crowns, chapter 13, verses 1 through 10, which represents Rome and other worldly powers. This beast will wage war against God's holy people as it rules over every tribe, people, language, and nation, chapter 13, verse 7. This beast becomes the object of worship, chapter 13, verse 4. The second beast emerges from the earth. It had a benign appearance, two horns like a lamb, but it spoke like a dragon, chapter 13, verse 11. Later in Revelation, this second beast is called a false prophet, chapter 16, verse 13, chapter 19, verse 20, and chapter 20, verse 10. The false prophet's goal was to compel people to worship the sea beast, for whom he erected an image which he then animated, and marking converts by putting a mark on their right hand or forehead that would allow them to participate in the economic life of the community. As explained in the commentary, the dragon, the sea beast, and the earth beast form a kind of unholy trinity, mimicking the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Revelation chapter 14 provides a counterpicture to the description of those who follow the unholy Trinity and in particular worship the image of the sea beast. Rather than the mark of the beast on their hand or forehead, the 144,000 who worship the Lamb on Mount Zion have the Lamb's name and the Father's name written on their foreheads. Chapter 14, verses 1 through 5. Three angels then fly across the sky, the first calling on people to fear God in the light of the coming judgment, the second announces the fall of Babylon the Great, a soon-to-be-developed symbol for Rome and other evil human kingdoms, chapter 16, verse 19, and chapter 17, verses 1 and 5, and throughout chapter 18, and the third announcing fearsome judgment against those who worship the beast and his image and receive his mark, chapter 14, verses 6 through 13. The chapter ends with two heavenly beings, each with a sickle, the first reaping the harvest, a positive image of gathering the faithful, while the other gathers clusters of grapes and throws them into the winepress, out of which blood freely flows, a negative image of judgment. We come to the third and final cycle of seven judgments, this time depicted as angels who pour out the contents of their bowls that lead to devastation. The second cycle, trumpets, chapter 8, verse 6 through chapter 11, verse 9, followed quickly on the heels of the first, seals, chapter 6, verse 1 through chapter 8, verse 5. They were also linked by the angels, with trumpets coming out immediately before the opening of the seventh seal. However, the cycle of seven bowls does not come right after the trumpets, but after a separate vision. Still, there are connections of this third cycle with the first two, as we will hear. There is also a link with the immediately previous vision when it is introduced as another great and marvelous sign, which refers back to the great sign that introduces the vision of the pregnant woman and the dragon and his beastly underlings, chapter 12, verse 1 and chapter 15, verse 1. This third cycle recapitulates the judgments of the first two cycles in a kind of spiral fashion. In other words, they are not 21 separate sequential judgments, but rather a rehearsal using different imagery of the same judgment, though the case can be made that this third sequence of seven does take matters further. First, there are no delaying interludes, giving the impression of rapidity. Further, we read by way of introduction that these are the seven last plagues, last because with them God's wrath is completed, chapter 15, verse 1, and with the pouring of the seventh bowl, we hear a loud voice from the heavenly throne, presumably God's, announcing it is done, chapter 16, verse 17. Just before the angels initially come with their bowls, those saints who had persisted despite their persecution worship God. Chapter 15, verses 3 and 4. Afterward, they pour out the contents of their bowls one by one. Similar to the first four seals and trumpets, the first four bowls form a unit by virtue of their brief narration, though the third is a little longer, and by the sequence of bringing harm to the earth, sea rivers and springs, and celestial bodies, similar to the trumpets. The fifth angel poured out the contents of his bowl on the throne of the beast, another linkage to the previous vision, so that its kingdom was plunged into darkness and its worshippers suffered agonizing pain. Still they did not repent. Compare chapter 16, verse 11, with chapter 9, verses 20 through 21. The pouring out of the contents of the sixth bowl dried up the Euphrates, the river that at the time separated the Roman Empire from the feared Parthians. Three frogs then come out of the mouth of the dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. These demonic spirits perform signs that result in the gathering of the kings of all the earth to a place called Armageddon for the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Chapter 16, verse 14. The seventh bowl produces meteorological and terrestrial convulsions reminiscent of the seventh seal and the seventh trumpet. There came flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, and a severe earthquake, chapter 16, verse 18. However, there is an escalation in the damage that these phenomena cause on the earth. The next vision is simply introduced in the Greek, not translated by the New International Version, by Kai, and or then. Still, The link to the previous episode of The Pouring of the Seven Bowls is provided when John tells the reader that one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls served as his guide during the vision. The vision, the subject of chapter 17, verses 3 through 6, starts with a description of a decadent prostitute who is later identified as Babylon the Great, a cipher for Rome. Revelation chapter 18 contains reactions to the fall of Babylon the Great and is connected to the vision by the simple, "After this." An angel first announces the fall, followed by another voice from heaven, likely the glorified Christ, urging his people to leave the city and thus avoid being collateral damage. Chapter 18, verses 1 through 8. A second and much different negative reaction comes from those kings, merchants, and sea captains who benefited from the prostitute, who represents Babylon the Great, which represents Rome, chapter 18, verses 9 through 17. The tone changes yet again from sadness to joy, as we hear the heavenly and earthly followers of God rejoice over her downfall, chapter 18, verse 20. Then an angel picks up a boulder and throws it into the sea to doom Babylon the Great. Chapter 18, verses 21 through 24. The transition from Revelation chapter 18 to chapter 19 is again marked by a simple "after this," which then leads to a great multitude in heaven singing praises. They are joined by the 24 elders and four living creatures. Chapter 19, verses 1 through 8. At the end of this section, an angel blesses those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. Chapter 19, verses 9 through 10. But the wedding supper does not take place immediately. The scene shifts, marked by John saying, "And I saw," to a new version of the final battle between Christ and the combined forces of evil, chapter 19, verses 11 through 21. In Revelation chapter 12, the dragon was defeated in heaven, after which he was hurled to earth, where he enlisted the sea and earth beasts in his unholy cause, chapter 13. Now we hear Christ's victory on earth as he rides out on a white horse, leading his angelic army and defeating the evil people and evil spiritual powers, represented by the beast and the false prophet being thrown into the lake of fire. Attention then shifts to the dragon, representing Satan, chapter 20, verse 2, who is initially seized and imprisoned in the abyss. After 1,000 years, he is freed, but then he is judged and thrown into the lake of fire, chapter 20, verses 7 through 10, followed by all the dead, and even death and Hades themselves being thrown into the lake of fire. Evil is once and for all definitively defeated, chapter 20, verses 11 through 15. After this final and climactic picture of judgment, the next sections present three major pictures of life for God's people after the eradication of evil. The first, drawn especially from Isaiah, see commentary, speaks of the new heavens and the new earth, chapter 20, verses 1 through 8. In this context, we also return, see chapter 19, verses 7 through 9, to wedding imagery, chapter 21, verse 2, as we do in the second picture of a new Jerusalem, chapter 21, verses 9 through 27, for wedding imagery, see chapter 21, verse 9. The third picture surrounds that of a new, restored Eden, only this Eden is better than the original, chapter 22, verses 1 through 5. The conclusion of the book of Revelation has two parts. First, chapter 22, verses 6 through 11, John's guiding angel gives him final assurance of the truthfulness of the visions and the command to not seal up its words, chapter 22, verse 9, because the time is near. John, tempted to worship this glorious, heavenly creature, is told to worship only God. Then, second, Jesus himself announces that he is coming soon to judge and confirms that he is the one who sent the angel to John, chapter 22, verses 12 through 21. The book signs off with a benediction typical of a letter, thus reminding us that the book as a whole is a letter to the churches. Commentary. Revelation chapter 1. Introduction to the book and the seven letters, chapters 1 through 3. Superscription and blessing, chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Chapter 1, verse 1. The Revelation from Jesus Christ. The term revelation translates the Greek word apokalypsis, which modern scholars have used as a genre label for books like Revelation, most notably the Book of Daniel that provides an Old Testament background to many of the themes, motifs, and metaphors in Revelation, as we will note in the commentary to follow. In addition to Daniel and Revelation, some other non-canonical books, including 2 Ezra, Book of Enoch, and 2 Baruch, have been identified as apocalyptic or as having apocalyptic features, jubilees. Apocalyptic books speak about God's judgment in the future and ultimately the end of time as a way of providing hope during present circumstances. The authors of these books present their visions to the faithful to comfort them during their struggles. Apocalyptic books utilize vivid figurative language, in part because they are speaking about the distant future and in part to capture the reader's attention. Many of the metaphors and similes of Revelation have a background in the Old Testament and the broader ancient Near East. The noun apokalypsis is in genitive relationship with the name Jesus Christ, the revelation of Jesus Christ, and the New International Version has rightly caught the correct sense of the genitive, that it indicates this is a revelation from Jesus, not really about Jesus, though of course Jesus will play a central role in this vision of the future. What must soon take place? As in Daniel chapter 2, verses 28 through 29, there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. He has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in days to come. Your dream and the vision that passed through your mind as you were lying in bed are these. As your majesty was lying there, your mind turned to things to come, and the revealer of mysteries showed you what is going to happen. As Osborne puts it, the prophecies of Daniel are seen throughout the book as coming to final fulfillment. In other words, what was in the distant future to Daniel now has a sense of immediacy to it. By sending his angel to his servant John. In Old Testament prophecy, God spoke directly to the prophet, who then was tasked with taking the message to the people with the purpose of eliciting repentance. In Revelation and Daniel before it, God gave his apocalyptic seer a vision and then sent an angel to provide an interpretation. For example, Daniel chapter 9, verses 21 through 22. The purpose of the vision was to comfort the faithful. Chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed is the one. The conferring of blessings of this sort may be found in the wisdom literature of the Old Testament, Proverbs chapter 3, verse 13, chapter 8, verse 34, and chapter 28, verse 14. See also Psalm 1, verse 1, and encourages wise behavior and attitudes with the inducement of benefits. See Revelation through Old Testament eyes, Psalms, at Revelation chapter 12, verse 5. There are 7 blessings conferred in the book of Revelation, starting with this one. See also Revelation chapter 14, verse 13, chapter 16, verse 15, chapter 19, verse 9, chapter 20, verse 6, chapter 22, verse 7, and chapter 14. Perhaps there is significance that the blessing sayings intensify toward the end of the book as it works through judgment toward a description of the new heavens and earth. The words of this prophecy. In the immediate previous section, we mentioned the difference between Old Testament prophetic books and apocalyptic books like Daniel and Revelation. Here, prophecy is used in the broad sense concerning matters pertaining to the future, both near-term future as well as the more distant future. Because the time is near. At the end of the book of Daniel, after Daniel had received 4 visions concerning the future, an angelic figure tells him, "Go your way, Daniel, because the words are rolled up and sealed until the time of the end." Daniel chapter 12, verse 9. The time that is said to be near in this verse is clearly the time of the end. No longer are the words to be rolled up and sealed as at the time of Daniel, but now are to be read aloud and heard. What the structure means: a letter, an apocalypse, and a prophecy. Revelation chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. Revelation chapter 1, verse 4 sounds like the opening of other New Testament letters. Compare Paul's letter to the Galatians as an example. The letter begins when Paul identifies himself as the writer of the letter, Galatians chapter 1, verse 1, and then identifies the recipients of the letter to the churches in Galatia, chapter 1, verse 2. Then he confers a benediction on the Galatians by saying, "Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ," chapter 1, verse 3. In the same way, after an opening superscription and blessing to be discussed in a moment, John identifies himself as the writer and goes on to identify the recipients of his letter to the seven churches in the province of Asia. He follows this with a benediction like the one found in the letter to the Galatians, "Grace and peace to you," Revelation chapter 1, verse 4. Unlike the letter to the Galatians and other letters in the New Testament, this epistolary opening does not begin the book of Revelation. Rather, the book starts with a superscription and a blessing. The superscription identifies the book as a revelation from Jesus Christ, chapter 1, verse 1, and explains that God made it known to John by sending an angel to him. The Greek word here translated revelation is apokalypsis, and as explained in the note to chapter 1, verse 1, gives its name to a genre of literature called apocalyptic. Thus, it's not sufficient to call Revelation a letter like all other letters in the New Testament. The opening also signals to us that it is an apocalypse, a highly symbolic depiction of the future, most similar to the book of Daniel. Though specifically an apocalypse, the book uses what might be considered a broader term, prophecy, to refer to the contents of the letter, chapter 1, verse 3. A prophecy is a vision of the future, usually a more near-term future, to speak to the issues of the prophet's contemporary audience. For that reason, the prologue here pronounces a blessing on those who hear and take to heart, chapter 1, verse 3, the message that is communicated by this book. That said, this apocalypse/prophecy is communicated to the seven churches in a letter. So we are not surprised that Revelation ends like most other New Testament letters with another benediction. Galatians ends when Paul writes, "The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ will be with your spirit, brothers and sisters. Amen." Chapter 6, verse 18. And Revelation ends by saying, "The grace of our Lord Jesus be with God's people. Amen." Chapter 22, verse 21. Greetings and Doxology. Chapter 1, verses 4 through 8. Chapter 1, verse 4. John, to the seven churches in the province of Asia. After the prologue to the book, chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, which speaks in the third person, John now begins his letter with what is a recognizable salutation to his intended readers, the seven churches in the provinces of Asia. In the Old Testament, seven is the number of completion or perfection. These seven churches may be representative of the larger number of churches in Asia. The location of these churches indicates that Asia refers to what we call Asia Minor, present-day Turkey, particularly on the western side. From him who is, and who was, and who is to come. God exists in the present, the past, and the future. As often pointed out, the background appears to be God's revelation of his covenantal name, Yahweh, at his meeting with Moses at the burning bush. At that time, God responds to Moses' request for his name by saying, "I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you." Exodus chapter 3, verse 14. John here reflects the Septuagint rendering of "I am," "ho on," "I am the one who is." One might expect the order, past, who was, present, who is, and then future, who is to come, like at Revelation chapter 4, verse 8. But here the emphasis might be on the present as a note of assurance to the immediate recipients of the letter. See also note at chapter 1, verse 8. The seven spirits before his throne. The New International Version footnote suggests that rather than seven spirits, we should think seven spirits is a reference to the sevenfold spirit, namely the Holy Spirit in all his magnificent perfection and completion. Many commentators believe that there is a reference here to Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2, which lists seven attributes of the Spirit of God. From this comes the suggestion of a Trinitarian reference in this verse and the next. However, more likely is Metzger's view that this is a reference to seven angels, who, according to Tobit, chapter 12, verse 15, are in the immediate presence of God. See Revelation chapter 4, through Old Testament eyes, God on his throne. What the structure means. The number seven in Revelation. The number seven permeates the book of Revelation. There are seven letters to seven churches, chapter 1, verse 4, and chapters 2 and 3. Seven spirits before the throne, chapter 1, verse 4. Seven golden lampstands, chapter 1, verse 12. Seven stars in the glorified Christ's right hand, chapter 1, verses 16 and 20. A scroll with seven seals, chapter 6, verse 1 through chapter 8, verse 5. A lamb with seven horns and seven eyes, chapter 5, verse 6. Seven angels blowing seven horns, chapter 8, verse 2, and chapter 8, verse 6 through chapter 11, verse 19. Seven bowls filled with plague, chapters 15 and 16. Seven thunders, chapter 10, verse 4. A dragon with seven heads and seven crowns, chapter 12, verse 3. A sea beast with seven heads, chapter 13, verse 1. Seven blessings, chapter 1, verse 3, chapter 14, verse 13, chapter 16, verse 15, chapter 19, verse 9, chapter 20, verse 6, chapter 22, verses 7 and 14. A city with seven hills, chapter 17, verse 9, and seven kings, chapter 17, verse 10. This symbolic use of the number seven has an Old Testament background and signifies completion, totality, and/or perfection. The root of this Old Testament symbol is most likely found in the seven-day week of creation, Genesis chapter 1, that becomes one way Hebrews determined a particular period that continues today. Examples of the symbolic use of seven in the Old Testament, signifying completion, totality, perfection, include the seven good cows and the seven ugly cows that represent 7 years of plenty and seven famine in Pharaoh's dream, Genesis chapter 41, verses 25 through 27, sprinkling the blood of a sin offering seven times on the Day of Atonement, Leviticus chapter 16, verses 14 and 19, and the Israelites under Joshua marching around Jericho for 7 days and seven times on the seventh day, Joshua chapter 6, verses 3 through 4. The use of symbolic numbers like seven is particularly common in apocalyptic literature. Symbolic numbers should not be pressed literally in a quantitative sense. Communicating the idea of completion leaves ambiguous whether only seven churches were the intended recipient of this letter, or whether there would only be three cycles of seven discrete judgments. Chapter 1, verse 5. From Jesus Christ. The Greek title Christ is equivalent to the Hebrew Mashiach or Messiah, and points to Jesus as the fulfillment of the anticipated anointed king who came to rescue his people. 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 16 and 17. The Faithful Witness. As Tab points out, Psalm 89, verse 37 points to the moon as the faithful witness in the sky, whose testimony is that God will assure that David's line will endure before me like the sun. Psalm 89, verse 36. Tab goes on to say that John goes further than Psalm 89 by identifying the risen King Jesus himself as the faithful witness, since he is also the one whose very self assures that David's line will endure forever. Firstborn from the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 15, Paul calls Jesus the firstborn over all creation, an obvious allusion to Proverbs chapter 8, verses 22 through 26. But here he is called the firstborn of the dead, not because he was the first person to die, but because he was the first person to die and be born from the dead through the resurrection. See also 1 Colossians chapter 15, verse 20, and Colossians chapter 1, verse 18. While Jesus had brought Lazarus back from the dead to show his divine power over death, John chapter 11 verses 38 through 44, Lazarus, unlike Jesus, died again. The reference to Jesus as the ruler of the kings of the earth seems to be a reference to Psalm 89 verse 27, where the psalmist remembers the divine announcement that David would be the most exalted of the kings of the earth, after saying that David was appointed as God's firstborn, and thus also providing a background to the reference to firstborn in this verse. The psalm is actually a lament bemoaning the decline of the Davidic monarchy, calling on God to restore their fortunes. Of course, neither David nor any of the kings in his line who ruled from Jerusalem were ever considered the most exalted of kings, except perhaps in God's eyes. But it is Jesus, David's greater son, who assumes that privilege due to his death and resurrection. Chapter 1, verse 6. Has made us to be a kingdom and priests to serve his God and Father. At Mount Sinai, God told Moses, "Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation." Exodus chapter 19, verses 5 and 6. Israel's special status was not to special privilege, but to serve God and be priestly intermediaries to the rest of the world. John here states that the seven churches of Asia and those that they represent now constitute God's kingdom and have the priestly responsibility to serve God on behalf of the rest of the world. The church, now made up of Jews and Gentiles, is a spiritual kingdom that is set apart for holy service. That position comes as a result of Christ's death, which has freed us from our sins by his blood. Revelation chapter 1, verse 5. Chapter 1, verse 7. Look, he is coming with the clouds. The picture of Christ returning with the clouds has an Old Testament and ancient Near Eastern background. In the ancient Near East, cloud riding was associated with storm gods like the Canaanite Baal, who is repeatedly called the rider of the clouds in the mythology of the Canaanites. Because of its association with the storm, we should picture this cloud here and in the biblical texts not as a white, fluffy cloud, but as a dark storm cloud. Psalm 18, verse 9, though see Revelation chapter 14, verse 14. The Old Testament poets and prophets, on several occasions, picture God riding a cloud into battle to rescue his people. In the magnificent and powerful description of God in Psalm 104, for example, we read that he makes the clouds his chariot and rides on the wings of the wind, verse 3. When the psalmist calls to God for help in the face of formidable enemies, we hear in response that God parted the heavens and came down. Dark clouds were under his feet. He mounted the cherubim and flew. He soared on the wings of the wind. Psalm 18, verses 9 and 10. In a prophecy against Egypt, Isaiah exclaims, "See, the Lord rides on a swift cloud and is coming to Egypt. The idols of Egypt tremble before him, and the hearts of the Egyptians melt with fear." Isaiah chapter 19, verses 1 and 2. In the opening to Nahum's oracle against the Assyrian city of Nineveh, we read that God, the divine warrior's way, is in the whirlwind and the storm, and clouds are the dust of his feet. Nahum chapter 1, verse 3. But John here cites a different, specific passage from the second scene of Daniel's first vision, namely Daniel chapter 7, verse 13. "In my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like a son of man, coming with the clouds of heaven." Daniel's opening scene, Daniel chapter 7, verses 1 through 8, pictures four horrifying beasts emerging from a chaotic sea. The sea and the monsters that are in it, or in this case emerge from it, are symbols of anti-creation forces of chaos and evil. Later in the chapter, an interpreting angel will announce that these beasts represent four kings that will rise from the earth, Daniel chapter 7, verse 17. They will ravage the earth, and in particular the people of God. The second scene, chapter 7, verses 9 through 14, changes the setting to a courtroom in which sits the Ancient of Days, a figure clearly to be identified with God, who is ready to issue judgments against the kingdoms represented by the beasts. Into his presence there arrives the one like the Son of Man riding a cloud. He is the one who will execute the Ancient of Days judgment on the forces represented by the beasts and the horns that emanate from the fourth beast. What is particularly striking about this passage is that it presents two figures in ways that associate them both with divinity. As mentioned, the Ancient of Days can only be God, but then only God can ride the cloud into battle. That this cloud-riding figure is called one like a son of man is particularly intriguing. In the Old Testament, son of man always means human being, but this figure is not a son of man, but like a son of man. Thus we have a human-like figure riding the cloud, a prerogative of God alone, into the presence of the Ancient of Days. No wonder John saw this figure as suggestive of Jesus at the end of time, when he will come to bring judgment on evil people and spiritual powers. And God was not the only one. The Gospels also picture Christ riding a cloud when he returns again at the end of time. Matthew chapter 24, verse 30, Mark chapter 13, verse 26, and Luke chapter 21, verse 27. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all people on earth will mourn because of him. After citing Daniel chapter 7, verse 13, John quotes Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10, and applies it to Christ, who will return on the clouds. Let's begin by turning our attention to the meaning of Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10 in its original context. Zechariah chapter 12 begins with the announcement that it is a prophecy. The word of the Lord concerning Israel, chapter 12, verse 1. Zechariah's prophecy begins by announcing that in the future, all the nations of the earth will gather against Jerusalem, and that God will watch over his people and will set out to destroy all the nations that attack Jerusalem. Chapter 12, verse 9. The next section of the prophecy, chapter 12, verses 10 through 13, begins by describing how God will transform his people by pouring out on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of grace and supplication. Chapter 12, verse 10. As a result, God's people will look to God, who is identified as the one they have pierced, and will mourn him. The idea that they have pierced God is metaphorical for their rebellion against God that led to their judgment in the first place, a judgment that is now going to be followed by their restoration. Their mourning will be intense, like the mourning of an only child or the weeping of Hadad Rimon in the plain of Megiddo, chapter 12, verse 11. The latter reference is obscure, but according to Boda, is likely a reference to weeping over Baal, often referred to as Hadad, whose adherents wept at his supposed death at the hands of the god Mot. If true, this reference is not an affirmation of the mythological elements of the story, but rather is simply pointing to an example of intense mourning. The New Testament saw a deeper meaning in the reference to the piercing of God in the crucifixion of Jesus. John reports that to hurry the death of Jesus and the two other men crucified along with him, that the soldiers decided to break their legs. But when they came to Jesus, they did not break his legs, but rather pierced his side with a spear. John ends the description of the crucifixion by citing Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10. They will look on the one they have pierced, John chapter 19, verse 37. We can now see how appropriate it is to cite this verse at the beginning of the book of Revelation. John recognizes that this day is the day anticipated by the prophecy of Zechariah chapter 12, the day when God would defeat the amassed enemies of his people. Jesus, the one who was pierced, is the one who will come to defeat those enemies and save his people. Interestingly, Revelation notes that it is all people of the earth, rather than just the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, as in Zechariah chapter 12, who will look on the pierced one and mourn. As Kostenberger points out, John in Revelation chapter 1, verse 7, transforms Zechariah chapter 12, verses 10 through 14, to show the fulfillment of the Abrahamic blessing of the nations through the suffering and reigning messianic seed. In this dual reference to Daniel chapter 7 and Zechariah chapter 12, we have an important theme that will reoccur in the book of Revelation. The divine warrior, the one coming with the clouds, is none other than the suffering servant of God, the one who was pierced. Revelation through Old Testament eyes. Daniel. Perhaps no book of the Old Testament has a bigger impact on the book of Revelation than Daniel, particularly Daniel chapter 7 through chapter 12. We should not be surprised at this similarity, given that Daniel chapter 7 through chapter 12 and Revelation are the only true apocalypses in the canon. The book of Daniel was written toward the end of the Old Testament period and addressed God's people when they were living under the domination of a foreign power. During Daniel's life, Jewish people were vassals under Babylon and then Persia. The book anticipates that later nations will succeed these two. Anticipating at least Greek domination, Daniel chapter 8 and chapter 11, but also beyond. By the time of the book of Revelation, the Romans had replaced the Greeks as the empire that controlled Jerusalem and Judah. Both books looked forward from their present circumstances where it appeared that evil forces were in control. And into that situation, God gave both Daniel and John the same message. Despite present troubles, God was in control, and he would win the final victory. This message was one of hope amid potential despair. In addition, God spoke through Daniel and John to encourage their contemporary readers to persist amid trouble. Both Jews at the time of Daniel and Christians at the time of John lived in a culture toxic to their faith. Receiving this message of hope intended to give them the strength to resist caving in to the culture. It did not mean that they would avoid suffering, but it did inform faithful readers that their suffering would have meaning and that it would lead to a better future. But not only a better future, God was also working in the present. He was in control despite present appearances. Daniel looks to the end of history when God will come and bring evil to an end decisively, once and for all. In Daniel chapter 2, Nebuchadnezzar has a dream that reveals a succession of kingdoms and culminates in the rock which represents a kingdom that will never be destroyed. Chapter 2, verse 44. That kingdom is none other than the kingdom of God. Grant Osborne clearly expresses the reason why the book of Revelation echoes the book of Daniel so often when he states that the prophecies of Daniel are seen throughout the book as coming to final fulfillment. It's not that Daniel did not foresee more events soon, but the book looked forward to the very end of history, which Revelation also anticipates. Both books announce God's final victory over evil to encourage God's suffering people during a difficult present. While God revealed to Daniel and through Daniel to his faithful people that God was going to win at the end, there is also the sense that this anticipated victory would not happen soon. At the end of the book, an angel, probably Gabriel, first instructs Daniel to roll up and seal the words of the scroll until the time of the end, chapter 12, verse 4, and then to go your way, Daniel, because the words are rolled up and sealed until the time of the end, chapter 12, verse 9. That they are sealed to the end does not mean that they are not able to read. After all, we hear these instructions after reading the book of Daniel, including its four visions and their interpretation. But what it means is that it is not yet time for the events of the end to take place. The book of Revelation, in contrast, was written after the first coming of Christ. He had died and been raised and then ascended into heaven. In his great redemptive acts, he had defeated the powers and the authorities, Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 through 15. But it was an already and not yet victory. Christ's act on the cross assured the final victory, but the complete realization of that victory will take place, according to the witness of the New Testament and in particular Revelation, at the time of his second coming. The book of Revelation testifies that with the first coming of Christ, we have moved into the end times that will be fully realized when Christ comes again. Therefore, whereas for Daniel the end was far off, now for John in Revelation, the time is near. Revelation chapter 1, verse 3. And the end is not something far off, but something that must soon take place. Revelation chapter 1, verse 1. The mystery that Daniel foresaw is something that will be accomplished according to the visions of the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 10, verse 7. The scroll that had been rolled and sealed, Daniel chapter 12, verses 4 and 9, in other words, that proclaimed the final judgment on evil and the rescue of the faithful, would now be unsealed by the Lamb who was worthy. Revelation chapter 5 through chapter 8. Chapter 1, verse 8. I am the Alpha and the Omega, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. The greeting and doxology end with the Lord God's self-identification in three parts. As typical of self-identifications, he begins by asserting, "I am," evoking memory of God's revelation of his name to Moses at the burning bush as "I am who I am," Eye Asher Eye, Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, see note at chapter 1, verse 4. He then goes on to state that he is the Alpha, the first letter of the Greek alphabet, and the Omega, the last letter. God thus says that he is the beginning and end, the first and the last, see also chapter 1, verse 18. Of course, by claiming the beginning and the end, he also claims everything in between. In this assertion, we can see a reflection of Yahweh's proclamation recorded in Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6, see also chapter 41, verse 4, and chapter 48, verse 12. "I am the first, and I am the last. Apart from me there is no God." In Isaiah, God asserts this claim over against the pretensions of the false gods whom the Israelites found so tempting to worship. In other words, there is only one God. R.H. Mounts provides a Greco-Roman background that suggests that perhaps this expression of God's eternality targeted a particular contemporary false god, namely Zeus. According to Mounts, in the Greek world, similar titles for the gods are found. In the Song of the Doves at Dondana, we read about Zeus who was, Zeus who is, and Zeus who will be. Pausanias, chapter 12. In Revelation, Jesus has died to free us from our sins so that we might serve his God and Father as citizens of his kingdom and priests. Then by citing Daniel chapter 7, verse 13, which associates Jesus with the one like the Son of Man riding the cloud, an implicit claim to divinity, and by saying that Jesus is the one who was pierced, citing a passage from Zechariah that referred to Yahweh, this passage associates Jesus with divinity. Thus, when the Lord God proclaims that he is the sole God, the Alpha and the Omega, we should not think this is a proclamation of the Father alone, but also of the Son and the Spirit. We should also hear an assertion of eternity that is made explicit in the following statement that he is the one who is, the present, and who was, the past, and who is to come, the future. He thus spans all time. God, therefore, exclusively fills the category God, the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. He also completely fills the category of time. Finally, he is the Almighty, Pantocrator, the Greek equivalent to the Hebrew Yahweh Sebaot, the Lord of Hosts. The hosts refer to God's heavenly army, and the use of Almighty contributes to the heavy emphasis on the triune God's role as warrior who comes to save his people. What the structure means. The clarified Christ commands John to write the seven churches. Revelation chapter 1, verses 9 through 20. In the previous verses, John addressed his letter to the seven churches of Asia, chapter 1, verse 4a. He then channeled a benediction from God and Jesus on the recipients of the letter, chapter 1, verses 4b through 5, and followed that with a dedication to Jesus and a call to be on the lookout for his return, chapter 1, verses 6 and 7. Jesus himself then provides a brief description of himself as the Alpha and the Omega, the one who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty, chapter 1, verse 8. Between the introduction of the letters and the letters themselves in chapters 2 through 3, John tells us that he met the glorified Christ, who commands him to write to the seven churches. Specifically, he exhorts him to write on a scroll what you see and send it to the seven churches, chapter 1, verse 11, and then again later, write therefore what you have seen, what is now, and what will take place later, chapter 1, verse 19. At the heart of this section, John describes his encounter with the glorified Christ in all his mysterious splendor, chapter 1, verses 12 through 16. In Christ's appearance to John and his command to write, we see his commission to his prophetic task like those that the Old Testament prophets experienced. Moses, the paradigmatic prophet, Deuteronomy chapter 34, verses 1 through 12, received his prophetic calling at the burning bush. There he met God, who commissioned him to go to Egypt to press Pharaoh to release the Israelites from their bondage, Exodus chapter 3. We might also think of Isaiah, who through a vision saw God enthroned in the temple where he accepted God's call to send someone to his people to call his people to repentance or face the threat of judgment. However, the closest parallel in this section, as will be detailed, is to Ezekiel's call to his prophetic task, Ezekiel chapters 1 through 3. Like Ezekiel, John was in the Spirit when he encountered the glorified Christ. See note to chapter 1, verse 10, and the description of Christ bears close analogy to what Ezekiel saw at the time of his prophetic commission. See note at chapter 1, verses 13 through 15. The similarities between the calling of John and the Old Testament prophets establishes his divinely given credentials as he writes to the churches. The glorified Christ commissions John, chapter 1, verses 9 through 20. Chapter 1, verse 9. On the island of Patmos. After his epistolary greeting, John now describes to his audience the seven churches of Asia, how the glorified Christ instructed him to write to them. He tells them that he is on the island of Patmos, a small island, approximately 34 square miles, off the coast of Asia Minor, today Turkey, where the seven churches were located. John has likely been exiled there because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus, and so considers himself a companion in the suffering with those whom he is writing. Chapter 1, verse 10. On the Lord's Day. John is about to recount his encounter with the glorified Christ, and he first tells the audience that it happened, appropriately enough, on the Lord's Day, a day set apart by the church for fellowship and worship. The background in the Old Testament is the Sabbath, the seventh day of the week, during which God's people were to cease their regular work. The Sabbath was established at the time of the creation, Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, mandated by the fourth commandment, Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 through 11, and Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 12 through 15, and considered the sign of the Mosaic covenant, Exodus chapter 31, verses 12 through 18. Thus, the Sabbath was to be strictly observed during the time of the Old Testament, though we have accounts of disobedience and the judgment that followed. Numbers chapter 15, verses 32 through 36, and Jeremiah chapter 17, verses 19 through 27. Surprisingly, however, Jesus suggests a change is forthcoming when during his life he flaunts contemporary Sabbath laws. His actions go beyond simply ignoring contemporary legalistic understanding of these laws to violate certain Old Testament requirements. We see this, for instance, when he allows his disciples to pick grain on the Sabbath, Mark chapter 2, verses 23 through 28, a practice clearly prohibited during the Old Testament period, Exodus chapter 34, verse 21, see also Exodus chapter 16, verses 25 through 29. Paul reflects theologically on the transition that takes place at the time of Jesus' coming. He tells the church, "Therefore do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ." Colossians chapter 2, verses 16 and 17.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.